In this video, we're going to talk about compound probability. You've had some experience with probability in the past. In seventh grade, you talk about simple probability, where you're just dealing with one event, one thing that's happening. So it could be you roll one six-sided die, and what's the probability that you roll a one? Or you flip a coin one time, what's the probability it lands on heads? Those are simple events, and that's kind of what you've worked with in the past. So if you look here in the simple probability, that's what I have here, seventh grade. There's usually only one event, and you write your probability as a fraction. So the numerator is your favorable outcome or what you're trying to get. So from one of my examples, I said if you roll a six-sided die and you land on a one. So if you think about it, you got six sides on a dice, numbered one through six, and your favorable outcome or what you're trying to get is a one. So one would go in my numerator. And then there are six possible outcomes. When I roll that die, I could get a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. So my probability would just be 1/6 because there's just one event. Well, in eighth grade, we do what's called compound events. So a compound event is an event that consists of two or more events. Okay, so now we're gonna flip two coins and we're gonna find the probability that they both land on heads, or one's a heads, one's a tails. So there are different models that we could use to help show all of our possible outcomes, and then from those possible outcomes we could choose the favorable outcomes that would help give us our probability. That's what we're going to look at here with these three examples of a tree diagram, an organized list, and a table. Once we get to an organized list and a table, you're going to think that those are pretty much the exact same thing, which they are. A table is just in a table, so they're really the same thing, just however you want to organize it. One thing I will note is that when we multiply simple events together, that gives us the compound probability. So if we think about if I roll two dice and I want to find out the probability of rolling a 3 and then a 4, well, that would take the probability of me rolling a 3 is 1/6. The probability of me rolling a 4 would also be 1/6. So I could take those and multiply them together. So the probability of that happening would be 1/36. Because I multiply my two fractions, 1 times 1, and then 6 times 6. So we'll look at these three diagrams here, and then we'll look at some examples. So our first diagram here is called a tree diagram. And we're gonna go off of this example right here. It says, show all possible outcomes of tossing three coins at the same time. And we're gonna find the probability of exactly one heads. Okay, so we have three coins. We'll say they're a fair-sided coin. We have heads on one side, a tails on one side. So we draw our tree diagram, and our first coin that we toss, we have two options. We could either land on tails, or we could land on heads. And I'm gonna put a one right here, signifying that was coin number one. Okay, so we could draw almost like some stems here that connect my tails and the heads there to represent that was my first coin. Okay, so then from there, I'm going to toss my second coin. But notice here I have branches coming off of the tails and the head, because my second toss depends on what I tossed my first coin, right? My first coin could have been a tails. So now my second coin also could be tails or heads. Well, if my first coin landed on heads, then I could still have these two possibilities of a tails and a heads down here. Okay, so I think you can kind of follow the pattern here. So now for coin number three, I do the same thing, tails and heads, tails and heads, tails, heads, and tails, heads. So that's coin number three. So there's three coins, and that shows our possible outcomes. So if you notice here, the last branch or the last coin is gonna tell us our total number of outcomes. So we could have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 total outcomes, right? And we said possible outcomes will be our denominator. So we're gonna put 8 in the denominator, okay? So now for the list, really all we're gonna do is we're gonna take this information and we're gonna put our possible outcomes together. We're gonna name them, okay? So our first outcome, we had tails, tails, and then tails. So we call that T, T, T. Tails, tails, heads. Tails, heads, tails. And then tails, heads, heads. Okay, so that's all if my first coin landed on tails. Okay, well, what if my first coin lands on heads? Well, then I have heads, tails, tails, heads, tails, heads, 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 tails, and then lastly, heads, heads, heads. And there's my organized list. And once again, I can see that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 possible outcomes. Okay, so now my table, I said it's gonna look pretty much exactly like my organized list. So we just make our table here, and we're gonna have our outcomes listed here. So we literally do the same thing, tails, 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 and we go all the way through, and it kind of just organizes our information a little bit better. But it lets us know once again that we have 8 possible outcomes. Okay, so now we can look at these three diagrams, and it says find the probability of exactly one heads. Well, we represented heads with the letter H, so, and then T represents tails. So now we're going to go through all of our 8 possible outcomes and choose each outcome that only has one H, because that means there's only one heads. Well, if we follow our tree diagram, tails, tails, tails. Well, we didn't have a heads there at all. Okay, tails, tails, heads. So this right here would be a favorable outcome. Tails, tails, heads. Tails, heads, tails. That's favorable because there's only one H. There's two H's on that one. Okay, heads, tails, tails. Only one H. Okay, and then we have heads, tails, heads. Heads, heads, tails. Heads, heads, heads. So if we notice here, there are only 3 favorable outcomes. So the probability of us tossing 3 coins at the same time and one of those coins, only one, exactly one, lands on heads. The probability is 3 out of 8. Okay, and we can see that here from our list as well. So you have one H there, one H there, 2, 1, 2, 2, and 3. So once again, 3 out of 8. And then we would have the same thing here. So one H, one H, and one H. Okay, so those are our 3 ways. There are 3 models that we could represent our sample space. And all the sample space is the information that they've given us. They told us, hey, we're going to toss 3 coins. So this is our sample space. Tree diagram, organized lists, and a table. Okay, so now we're going to look at some examples of some problems that we could do here. Okay, so example number 1 says a bag contains 1 B tile, 1 I tile, and 1 N tile. If you randomly pick 3 letters from the bag, 1 at a time, in order, without replacement, what is the probability you will choose a B first or last? Okay, well, one key thing here that we need to note is that it says without replacement. So kind of think about what that means. If I'm reaching my hand into a bag and I draw out a tile, if I do not replace it, that just means I do not put the tile back into the bag. Okay, so you might get a question that says with replacement. So that just means, hey, you draw something out, take a look at it, and then you put it back in the bag. So that's a key difference there, because with or without replacement is going to determine my possible outcomes. Okay, well here we do not replace the tile that we put in. Okay, so here we're gonna use a tree diagram. All right, so let's make our diagram. Let's say we have 3 possible tiles here, right? So the first time we reach in, we have 3 options. We could draw the B tile, we could draw the I tile, or we could draw the N tile. All right, that was our first draw, okay? Well then from there, if I draw B first, I have 2 options, right? I could draw I, or I could draw N. Okay, then so that's my second draw. So then my third draw, well, if I drew B then I, then I have to draw N. If I drew B then N, then we have to draw I. So there's our first, second, and third draw if we drew the letter B first. Okay, now we're gonna do the same thing with I. So after we draw I, we can either draw B or N. If we draw I, B, then it's N. If we draw I, then N, then we're left with B. And then lastly, if we drew N first, then we have 2 options for our second draw. We could draw B, then we could draw an I. If we draw N, then B, then we're left with I. And if we draw N, then I, then we're left with B. So this is going to tell us how many possible outcomes we have looking at here at the end. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we have 6 possible outcomes. Now we're looking for the favorable outcomes, or what they're wanting us to figure out. So they're trying to figure out, or we're trying to figure out, what's the probability that we will choose a B either first or last. Okay. Well, right here we have BIN, so there's a favorable. BNI, also favorable. Now, these two down here start with I and N, so we need to check the last letter now. Okay, there's a B, and there's a B. So how many stars we have? We have 4 stars, which means we have 4 favorable outcomes, and we have 4/6 is our probability, and we could see that we could reduce that to 2/3. So our answer would be 2/3. So we have a 2/3 probability to draw B first or last. So fairly good odds on that question. All right, our next example says a game show host says that you can win $1 million if you can draw all 4 aces in a row out of a standard deck of playing cards. It says, what is the probability you win given you do not replace each card that you draw? So here, once again, we're going to be dealing with without replacement. And so we have to have a little bit of knowledge of playing cards here. We need to know that there are 52 cards in a deck, 52 playing cards. On this particular question, we don't have to know anything about the suits or anything like that, but it would be helpful sometimes to know that there are 4 suits and there are 13 cards for each suit. Okay, so that's just some helpful information that we might need to know one day. All right, so if we take a look here, there are 4 suits and there's 13 cards in each suit. So that's going to tell us how many aces there are. And even though the question told us that there are 4 aces, that's still helpful information for us to know. So when we look at our deck of cards, there are 52 total cards that we could draw on our first draw, right? 52 cards. Well, we're trying to draw an ace, and there are 4 of those. So that means there's 4 favorable outcomes. So on our first draw, the probability of us drawing an ace is 4 out of 52. And we could reduce that, but we're going to wait and do that at the very end. So now, if you remember, we said that at the very beginning that we can multiply simple events together to get the compound probability. Okay, so now let's think about our second draw. Now we have to take into account that we drew an ace on the first draw because it's a possibility. So now let's say we drew 1 ace out. How many are left? Well, there's only 3 left now, and we're not replacing that card. So now there's not 52 cards in the deck. Now there are 51 cards. So our probability now to draw an ace again is 3 out of 51. Then our third draw, we have to take into account that we drew an ace again. So now there are only 2 aces, and we're not putting it back. We are not replacing, so now there's only 50 cards in the deck. And hopefully you can see our pattern here. And then our last draw, our fourth draw, there's only 1 ace left, and there are 49 cards in the deck. So those are all of our simple probabilities. So to get the probability that happens 4 times in a row, which is extremely unlikely, we're going to see in just a minute, we would multiply all those numbers together. So when we're multiplying fractions, I'm going to do it down here. 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, that gives us 24. And then we multiply these numbers together, 52 times 51 times 50 and times 49. And that gives us 6,497,400. So a very, very tiny number there. All right, and we can reduce this. 6,497,400 happens to be divisible by 24. So we can divide the top and the bottom by 24. And that gives us our probability of 1 out of 270,725. Okay, so if you did this 270,725 times, the odds of you drawing 4 aces in a row, 1 chance out of 270,725. So not very good odds there. All right, last question. It says a spinner has 3 equal sized sections labeled A, B, and C. So here's our spinner right here, A, B, and C. A number cube has sides labeled 1 through 6. So kind of like a die. What is the probability that we roll an even number and land on B? Okay, so once again, we can multiply here because these are 2 simple events that we're going to find out the compound probability by just multiplying the simple events together. All right, so it says that we're going to roll an even number. Well, if we have a dice or a number cube, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. So our even numbers there, we have 2, 4, and 6. So we had 6 possible, 3 out of 6 is our probability. And we could go ahead and reduce that to 1/2, or we could do that at the end. And we'll just leave it as 3/6 for now. Now it says, what's the probability that we also land on B? Well, there's only one B, and there are 3 sections. Okay, so now we multiply those together. 3 times 1 is 3, 6 times 3 is 18. So we have a 3 out of 18 chance, and we could reduce that because 3 and 18 are both divisible by 3. So our final answer would be 1/6. So we have a 1/6 chance of landing the spinner on B and rolling an even number on the dice. Okay, so compound probability, just remember there are ways we can organize our information, tree diagram, organize a list, and a table. And in the event that we see we might not have to organize our information, then all we have to do is take our simple events, our simple probabilities, which are the favorable outcomes over the possible outcomes, and we just multiply all those together to give us our compound probability.